right now we're gonna call for Pastor Leah to give us her message. She is the founding senior pastor of the Heart of God Church and the chief people officer, global director of Generations.
All right, without further ado, please welcome her with a warm applause.
Well, it's been an honor to be here to share in this space, and thank you everyone for serving, and I know that everyone has sacrificed to be here because you guys are doing a lot of things and you've taken time to be here. And today, if you recall, the first session I had, I talked about deep bench, and if you recall, I said that working with young people sometimes is not easy and they make mistakes. And the very same thing that they did during my first session was that they played the wrong video. So I think if I need to be a good pastor, I won't be a good pastor if I do not allow the team that is here with me and the team that is back home to redeem the mistake. So today we're going to show you the video that we're supposed to be shown on the first yesterday session. Just to recap a little bit, it's about the deep bench. And deep bench means having many layers and levels of volunteers and leaders, all with the same caliber, serving God at the same time. And the ideal for deep bench is really to have three teams in church, so that, you know, the only team, sometimes in our churches, the team that serves, the worship team, we get them to serve every week until Jesus Christ comes back. So we need a deep bench. So the ideal is to have three teams, one team serving, one team training, and the other team doing something very important, which is resting. So we're going to roll you the video that was supposed to be shown yesterday, and I guarantee you it's going to be a good few minutes of your life. So let's roll the video. Thank you.
Every time I come to Heart of God Church, I'm always amazed. They seem to be taking new ground, but it's not always the same old leaders. But rather, Heart of God Church are intentional about building a pipeline of brand new leaders and volunteers every year. It's kind of what Pastor Leah refers to as the deep bench, where we've got both levels and layers of leaders, all with equal caliber, serving at the same time. And that's what I'm here to show you today. Come on, let's take a look.
Hi, Dr. Robbie.
Hey guys, what's going on here?
We are now preparing for a photography training for our youngest photographers.
Youngest? What? So you mean you're not the youngest?
I'm already 15, but now I'm training photographers as young as 6 years old to shoot in our main services.
Okay, so you must be like a photography legend.
Oh no, when I first joined the ministry at 12 years old, Winnie trained me from scratch, and now she's training me to train others.
Wow, so how is it that you train such young photographers?
We actually adapted our main training syllabus to teach them how to use professional cameras and to also plan their shots.
Yes, and you know, after services, we actually evaluate their photos and debrief them as well.
Now that's what I call intentional.
And here they come.
Hi, Doctor.
Hey, guys. Now, how old are you?
I'm 8. I'm 7.
I'm 6.
Shall we take a selfie together?
Yeah, come on, let's grab a selfie. Okay, so you need to send me that photo. Hey, look, I hope that this encourages you that anybody can build a deep bench. All you need is a heart for young people, just gather them together and start training. That's how Heart of God Church started. But then they took their trainings and turned it into a syllabus for their pipeline. Oh wait, I see somebody familiar. Hey, Singh.
Hey, Dr. Robbie.
So good to see you.
Now,
the first time that we met, you were only 15. And I think at that time, you'd only been in church for like a year, but you were already the camera director and in charge of something like 16 cameras. Is that right?
Yes. So that was 4 years ago and I'm currently 19 years old. So time flies.
Wow, very cool. And what are you doing now?
So currently I'm an ops coordinator, and from directing 16 cameras, I'm now training ops coordinators who direct 8 different media departments to run our services.
Amazing.
Yeah, so George over here is also an ops coordinator and he is only 16 years old this year.
Hey, George.
Hi, Dr. Robbie. So in fact, Singhi was the one that actually trained me, and now together we are also training the next generation of ops coordinators together.
So we're doing a debrief and evaluation of the past 2 weekends. George over here actually led the team in Imaginarium to run services, while I led another team to run and set up services at another venue for 5,000 people.
Another team. So you have more than one team. You've got 2 full teams.
Actually, we have one more team and that team is resting. So in total, we have 3 teams.
Wow, multiple teams, equally skilled, and you've even got enough space for one team to be resting. So wait, what is it that you do?
Oh, I'm the team that's resting.
All right, jokes aside, I oversee the media and events department in our church.
Okay, so tell me your story. How did you get here?
So, it's all about training. I joined the Lights Ministry when I was 13 years old, and at 16, Pastor Leah challenged me to lead the entire Lights Ministry. And that's when I started to train Lights Crew, and that freed me up to become an Ops Coordinator. And as an Ops Coordinator, I started to train others like Sing Yi and George, and that allowed me to take on even more.
Wow, now some leaders are a little bit hesitant to train up others for fear of being replaced, but you clearly don't feel like that.
Yes, definitely not. Pastor Leah taught us that generations are not replacements, generations are reinforcements. And the younger generation is not here to push us out, but they are here to push us up.
That is epic. Look, I hope that you are inspired by what you see here. This is what happens when you are committed to relentlessly building generations and training a pipeline of brand new leaders and volunteers. Look, everyone can build a deep bench and a strong church, even you.
All right. Thank you. Well, today I am speaking on generations, and many years ago, God gave me a verse, and it is my life verse. It's in Isaiah 58, verse 12. It says, "You shall raise up the foundations of many generations." So when I'm talking about generations, I don't mean just my generation or the next generation, but I'm talking about many, many, many generations and building all of them. When we say generations, people immediately think of succession. People think of an older person retiring or dying and a younger person stepping in to replace the older person. Well, that concept is succession. But generations is not succession, because generation is not about replacement, right? Generations are not replacements, generations are reinforcements. It is about having many, many layers and levels of leaders serving at the same time. So if it is about succession, it is too slow. Because imagine a 70-year-old pastor looking for a 50 or 40-year-old to replace him. That is a little too slow and a little too late. So in our church, we are very, very intentional in reaching the young people. Every few years, we start a youth group in Heart of God Church as the preceding generation grows up. It is like a moving target. Reaching young people is so hard. It is like moving downward on an upward escalator. It's like running down an upward escalator. They grow up so fast. So how did we start? Well, many years ago, you know, if you come to Heart of God Church now, you see the screens, you see the runway, but we didn't start out like that. Many, many years ago, more than 20 years ago, we started with just 9 teenagers. And so 1999, I saw some really bored-looking kids in Children's Church, and I brought them out older and started a teenage connect group. And so that was 1999. We started with 9 teenagers, and we affectionately call them the 9 stones, because they will not worship, they will not pray, and they will not laugh even when I tell my best joke. So it was really rough, but how many of you know the Bible says that even the rocks will cry out and praise Jesus? So they got on fire. That was the first youth ministry, the start of the youth ministry. They got on fire for Jesus. Now, when they started to grow up, I went back down to reach the next generation. So in 2006, I took a few of the first generation of youth with me, and we started a brand new zone for the 13 and the 14-year-olds, and we started reaching them. So we call it Zone F, Zone of the Future. Started with 20 people. And in 2013, we started another youth group. We went back down to reach the 13 and 14 and 15-year-olds, and we called it Zone M, the Millennial Zone, and it was launched with 114 people. 2016, we started again. We started a new zone, and the average age of that zone was 12.9 years old. It is the Gen Z group. We call it Zone Z, and it was launched with 100 people. Then 2021, just like a couple of years ago, we launched yet another youth group. We went back down to reach another generation. So there were 200 people when we launched the Alpha Zone, and they had an average age of 13.4. So every generation, they get to grow up and they get to grow old together. So with each generation, there are hundreds of leaders and volunteers serving together, grow up together, and they all get married about the same age, which is a good thing in church. Now, so we have been building youth for more than 2 decades now, and in our church, we have built many generations of young leaders. So right now, we have already built our 7th generation of young leaders, and each generation is only about 3 to 5 years apart. That's right. If you look at the screen, you know, they're all only about 3 to 5 years apart. They came in at 13, 15, 17, but many of them are grown up now. They are like in their 20s, in their 30s, and today they are leaders, pastors, hundreds of them. You know, they are all heads of departments, most of them. And so if you see, now recently, in fact, we have promoted 3 from the first generation to become senior pastors. They were the ones who came in at 13 years old and, you know, 12 and 8. Oh my. And then so now they are senior pastors. So they are all in their 30s right now. And of course, we also have 4 more homegrown pastors we have recently promoted. So generations, it is so important for our church because this is how we ensure longevity, renewal, and an endless pipeline of ignited youth, volunteers, and leaders knowing God, loving Him, serving Him, that are coming through all the time. Amen? So those pictures that you see in the generations, they're just representation of their generation. They're the leaders. And then actually behind them, there are lots of them, hundreds of them in generations, in each generation. Now, when you build your church younger, it also gets stronger. The young people are not replacing the older generation, but they are reinforcing them. Nobody is being replaced. The first generation is still serving alongside the 6th and the 7th generation. So what we do is that we go to the young people and we always tell them to honor the older youths for all their sacrifices. And we always tell them that they're standing on the shoulders of the older generation. Well, in turn, we turn to the older generation and we tell them to respect and give space to the younger people. And we say, you know what, in Heart of God Church, it's never about, you know, we don't have a closed circle. We always give space for the young people coming up. And so we tell them all the time, hey, the young people are not here to replace you, but they are here to reinforce you. The young generation, we should never be afraid to let them rise up because they are not here to push us out, but they are here to push us up. So when we intentionally focus on building the youth and young adults, our church not only grow bigger, but they grow younger and stronger. And these reinforcements, they will come alongside you and they will strengthen what you are doing for God in your church. They will strengthen your mission. They will strengthen your legacy in your church. Amen. So now today, you know, I have brought almost like as many representation from the generations, as many as I could fly over. And, you know, in my team, I brought them. They're from the first generation, and then they are from the second generation, and they are also from the 6th generation, the 4th generation. So it covers a pretty wide range. And you've heard all their stories in the workshop, in yesterday's session. And today we're going to hear from our most recently promoted pastor, and he was from the first generation. If you would see... That's him, and if you would know, you know, standing right there on the right is Valerie. You heard her speak the other day when I wasn't around yet, so that was there. And then there's Pastor Daniel, and he's got a very amazing story because he's like a dinosaur in our church. He's been there for years, since he was very young, and today, we seldom bring this testimony overseas, but today, I'm so glad that he could join us, and we can't wait to hear what his story is all about. All right, so I bring you the original stone from the first generation. Let's give a big hand to Pastor Daniel.
Hi, I'm Daniel and I'm 38 this year. So I'm a pastor of doctrine, a worship leader, and I lead 220 people. I came to Heart of God Church over 20 years ago, and I am one of the 9 stones from the first generation. When I was 12, Pastor Howe found out that Pastor Garrett and I were interested in learning the guitar. So he formed a guitar class for us, and he taught us our first four chords of G, D, E minor, and C. So when I was 14, Pastor Leah started the first teen cell group in church. We had little or zero musical abilities, but she empowered us to be the very first youth worship team. She even subsidized my guitar and piano lessons, and I was very touched. When I was 16, during a worship rehearsal with Pastor Leah, we flowed into deep worship and she prayed for us. I saw a vision in my heart of me leading worship before thousands, lifting their hands to God. I was captivated and I kept that vision in my heart. A year later, Pastor Leah told me, "Daniel, you can sing. Why not be an anointed worship leader for God?" So that's how, at 17, I started worship leading in church. During this time, I started taking baby steps in songwriting. So one day I casually mentioned to pastors about my songs, and the next week, they came to my house just to listen to them. To my relief, I think they loved every song. And they even asked me to play one of them in service. And the song was titled, "Fly Away." So please don't ask me how that is a Christian song, okay? I was just a young Christian boy then. So then I found my pastor's belief in me. And I remember in the teens camp, Pastor Leah prayed that I would one day hear the music of heaven and I would write them down. And I felt the weight of God's anointing and I was inspired. Who knew that from scribbling songs in my bedroom, years later I would be part of the songwriting team that recorded our church's first full-length album. And Pastor Lee was strong on discipleship. So for a season, she noticed that I started to value secular music over worship music. So she got me to fast from secular music for a period. She then took away my entire secular CD collection for safekeeping. And I started spending more time in worship. And I would find myself tearing, and I wasn't really missing my CDs, okay? I was genuinely touched by God, and I found myself becoming more sensitive to the Holy Spirit's leading. Pastor Howe, he always believes that what young people lack in experience, we can make up with exposure. So Pastor sent me to New Zealand to attend one of the largest Christian music festivals in the world with over 25,000 attendees. You know, they also sent me to Sydney, Australia, where I played the guitar at a young adults conference in front of a foreign crowd. And when Matt Raymond invited Pastor Howe and Pastor Leah to attend his live album recording, they gave me the opportunity to go instead. It was held at Abbey Road Studios in London, where the Beatles recorded their iconic album. You know, it's every musician's dream destination. And I felt so valued and I learned so much. After I graduated from university, I started working full-time in church. And I assumed that my main role would be in the worship ministry. But Pastor Leah told me, "Hey, your job is just to say, 'God, I want to serve you.' Music is just one area that God can use you in. So don't limit what God can do through you." And from there, I prayed, "God, lead me wherever you want me to go." Well, another passion that I had was to study theology. So even as a teenager, I spent hours reading my study Bible. And Pastor Leah knew this, and she gifted me with two thick Bible commentaries. And in one of them, she wrote, "Dear Daniel, love the word. Preach the word. The thing that will set you apart from other worship leaders of the world would be that you are not just a man of worship, but a man of the word as well." And so those words shaped the course of my life. And in the other book, she wrote, "Dear Daniel, build the depth of the deep bench in the worship team. Reproduce people of the word." Those messages were from decades ago, but today she is still preaching these fundamentals. Then when I was 29, pastors asked if I wanted to do my master's in theological studies, and they believed that I could be both a worship leader and also a teacher of the word. Now, studying theology was my dream, and I could never have afforded it. But they gave me a scholarship from church and they sent me to Regent University in Virginia Beach in the United States to pursue my master's. And after 4 years, I graduated with a Master of Theological Studies, and my pastors flew for over 30 hours just to celebrate with me. And they were smiling, they were tearing and clapping, and I was just so grateful. All in all, I thank God for His faithfulness and His calling over my life. This year, I was commissioned as a pastor of doctrine in Heart of God Church. And during one preacher's training, thank you. During one preacher's training, Pastor Leah challenged me as a pastor. And she said, Daniel, you need to be a pastor of doctrine, especially for the young people, because they need the absolute truth of God. And there was such a great presence of God in that moment. So, you know, I just want to thank my pastors for seeing something in a stubborn stone of a teen like myself. That is why today I'm a homegrown pastor in Heart of God Church. And I believe that there are many more to come. Thank you.
Oh, let's give Daniel a big hand. Thank you, Daniel. Pastor Daniel. Well, you know, so Pastor Daniel is from the first generation and he's still serving God today in our church. And he's not been replaced, even though the other generations has come through as well. In fact, somebody on my team is Giselle. She's from the sixth generation. And she's a Gen Z. She's a bassist on the team. But she has not replaced Pastor Daniel. In fact, both of them have been serving on the worship team together. And this is a photo of them. He's not been replaced. And this is a typical sight in Heart of God Church, where the older generation is serving together with the younger generation. Nobody has been replaced. And in fact, on the songwriting team, they came together and write songs. And we did this really fun album called the XYZ album, where it's such an eclectic mix of different songs because every generation was writing their own sound. And it was such a fun time just coming, seeing the generations come together to produce music. So now, because Giselle, right, from sixth generation, she rose up on the worship team. That is why Daniel, Pastor Daniel, can be pushed up and be commissioned as a pastor. And then as Pastor Daniel and Pastor Ilu, whom you heard the testimony from of the last session, as Pastor Ilu and Pastor Daniel, they rose up from the second generation to become pastors, they came in to reinforce the first three pastors that we had and push them up to become senior pastors. Nobody is being replaced. All serving God at the same time. Not pushed out, but pushed up. Amen? So, you know what? I have one more testimony from you. We can't leave this place without hearing from a Gen Z herself. So, we are going to ask, you know, Giselle to come up and share her testimony. But I want you to take notice that between her, the picture that you saw of Giselle and Pastor Daniel on the worship team, between those generations, there's a gap of 19 years. But if you were to talk to them, you would know that they have the same value system, they have the same passion for Christ, and they have the same idea of what ministry is all about. So today, I'm going to last testimony for this today, and so I'm going to invite Giselle up to stage. Let's give her a big hand. All right.
Yes. Hi, I'm Giselle and I'm 19. I'm from the sixth generation of leaders. And I was saved in Heart of God Church as an ordinary 12-year-old. I was so shy. If you asked me to speak to just three other people, I would say no thanks. But because I've been loved, trained and discipled, I'm here now. And this is my story. I've always loved music and I can't live without my headphones. At 13, God spoke to me to use my interest in music for Him. And I thought, wow, really? My love for music can be used for something bigger? It all fell into place when I picked up the bass in church. I had no musical background, yet the leaders in church patiently trained me from scratch. After 7 months, I was part of the new youth worship team, and I was only 13. The day we made our debut was so special. The music we played was touching lives for Jesus. Over the next few years, my pastors and trainers continued to help me grow as a bassist through rehearsals and debriefs. Pastor Leah and Pastor Howe brought me to concerts to gain exposure and paid for my tickets. They brought me to my first musical too. That night, I was simply vibing along to the music. Little did I expect to receive a message from Pastor Leah the next day. She told me she loved my spirit of being simple as I clapped, lifted my hands, and enjoyed the moment. I was surprised. Even in the midst of the performance, she noticed such details to encourage me. Pastor Leah then told me, "Giselle, you need to work on your bass. It's a gift God has given you. The next generation's musicality is on your shoulders." I felt so believed in and inspired to glorify God even more through my playing. All this while, beside playing the bass, I didn't think I had other strengths. I thought I was too quiet. I'm more of a behind-the-scenes kind of person. Still, my leaders told me, "You can lead." When I was 14, they gave me a few people to take care of and guided me along the way. But I still had my doubts. Then, when I was 15, Pastor Leah felt led to pray for me in a service. She prayed, "Though you may be quiet, you will lead in confidence." She then gave me her own jacket. On it, she wrote the words, "The revival carries on with you." Those words injected faith that chased away my unspoken doubts. Every time I wore that jacket, I was reminded to lead with confidence in God. From leading 4 people in a year, I grew to lead a connect group of 11. Pastor Howe and Pastor Leah continued to call out my strengths. They told me I had a unique flair for music and creativity and showed me how I could help bring creativity to the forefront of our church. Soon, we started a youth creative team and I was part of it. I loved every opportunity to create and serve. It's easy to look at us and see the fun and chaos that Gen Z brings. But what's often unseen is how our character is being built behind the scenes. At 16, some of my friends and I were on a church internship program. But we came for meetings unprepared, preoccupied, and sometimes even late. So in one meeting, Pastor Howe firmly shared that our attitudes were concerning. We were passive, not participative, and did not treasure our seats at the table. Then, that's when it struck me. I was taking opportunities given to me for granted. I realized I had to change to be a proactive person and be a team player. From there, I disciplined myself to be on time, to prepare and contribute. It built me to be someone who gives my best regardless of when or where. Another time, Pastor Leah corrected the worship team, but she noticed I wasn't the most receptive. She told me she was concerned my heart wasn't open to discipleship. I didn't have the right attitude to be humble and have a servant's heart. She then said, "The higher you go, the lower you serve. It's good for our hearts." Her words were not easy to swallow, but I'm so thankful my pastors love me enough not to sugarcoat the truth. I evaluated and told Pastor Leah how I wanted to grow. She went on to teach me to find scripture verses so I could anchor my decision in God's word. As I prayed with those verses, I sensed a shift in my heart and spirit. I realized I never want to come to a point where I'm too hardened to be molded to be who God has called me to be. Today, I'm a bassist on the worship team. I lead a connect group of 30 people, and I'm part of the creative team. Every time I take a step back and look at where I'm at, I feel so grateful. Because just 7 years ago, I was a 12-year-old feeling small and unimportant. I didn't share this, but my dad left my family when I was 8. Ever since, I felt like I didn't matter, and I thought I would feel this way forever. But God found me. It is in church where I felt the love of my Heavenly Father, and I found spiritual parents in Pastor Howe and Pastor Leah who poured so much in me. Recently, they even brought some of us along for their family trip to Australia. I made some of my best memories there, waking up at 4 a.m. to ride the hot air balloon, going for my first Australian Open tennis match, and more. On that trip, I saw what a godly family could be like, and that gave me faith for my future. I thank God for finding an ordinary girl like me and giving me an extraordinary destiny. Also, thank you to my pastors for loving me, amplifying my strengths, and refining my character. I can only be who I am today as I've been discipled as a youth in Heart of God Church. Thank you.
Let's give Giselle a big hand. Wow. such an incredible testimony. And if you can see, the heart is the same throughout all the generations because they're just getting trained and discipled all the time, and we're relentless about that. And you know, for us, by right, Pastor Daniel has shared his testimony. In his own right, he's well capable to preach his own sermon, but he has kindly said yes to sharing his testimony in my sermon today. And you know, for me and my husband, when we started the church, we didn't have the time, the money to study for our Master's of Divinity. So we just went to a local school, a local Bible school. But years later, when we could afford to, we decided to send our next generation pastors to study instead. So we sent them to ORU, we sent them to Regent University in the States. So our pastors, they have Masters of Divinity and Master of Theological Studies. And when they got it, we were so happy for them. And we went to the States just to celebrate with them. And actually, in recent years, we have sent another batch of youths, of young people, to go study their Masters of Divinity. And we were so happy that, you know, they graduated as well recently. And we just, you know, I talk about this because these are like milestones in our church history. These are like milestones in our lives. How many of you know that the generations coming after, they're going to be better than us? Amen? Come on. So, let me share with you one last principle I've always lived by. We need to give encouragement, not endorsement. The people who need our praise and encouragement the most are those who have not yet made it in life, not the ones who are already famous and great. When you praise someone before they become great and famous, it's encouragement. But when you praise someone after they become great and famous, it's merely endorsement. Young people that are around us, they have no money, they have no belief in themselves, so they need us now before they are successful, not after. When we give them encouragement now, we are really encouraging them. But when we are saying their praises and being associated with them after they are great and famous, that's merely endorsement. Amen. How many of you say we give encouragement and not endorsement? The young people, they need us now. And I have one last video to show you. And we are going to end with this video, and I'm just going to pray, and then that's done. So kids from the first generation, if you recall, three of them, they are, when they were youths, they were so young, but we gave them encouragement, and now they are senior pastors in our church, and that's how they are like Pastor Lynette, Pastor Charleston, Pastor Garrett. They are all senior pastors. All five of us shared leadership in the church. They grew up together, and they're going to grow old serving Jesus together. And so, with the next video, I want to plant a visual in your heart. I want you to know that this can happen in your church as well. The senior pastor, the next senior pastor, the next theologian, the next worship leader, the next bassist, they are all found in your youth group right now. So, let's watch the video. Well, would you stand up with me right now? And I just want to do a short prayer and invite my team to come up. And let's just have like 30 seconds of prayer for a moment, and then we're done. Tonight, I want to encourage anyone here who's involved in youth work, and you're so discouraged. Well, I want to let you know that the fruit is coming if we just keep plowing and just keep sowing good seeds. Amen. Come on, let's lift up our hands and we pray. Father, God, your word will never return to you void. And whatever is said in this room, I know, God, that you take it and you put it into their hearts and you empower the hands that have heard these words and you empower them to build your house strong. You empower them to reach young people in a way they've never done before. Father, I pray for anyone who's discouraged in this room. I ask, God, that you give them a vision in their heart of what it can be. And I pray all the visions, all the videos, all the testimonies are assigned to them, God, that all things are possible with you. And I pray you will strengthen their hands, God, as they continue to plow amongst the young people. And I ask, Father, for those who think it's impossible, I pray that all that I've shown, God, in all these sessions, you would take this, you put inside of their heart, God, and you give them great faith and great tenacity and great persistence to bring it back to their movement, to bring it back to the churches. And they will know, God, that as their hearts turn towards the young people will start flocking to their midst. Father, we thank you, we honor you, and all the glory goes back to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give Jesus a big hand. Thank you.